Hello everyone, in this video we will see the 8086 IO programming. So this is a single bus structure for 8086. So if you see, we have the CPU and bus control logic to which the data bus, control bus and address bus are connected. So these buses are required to interface with a memory and also to a peripheral IO device. So for communicating with the IO device, we have IO interface which consists of number of IO ports. So these IO ports also have addresses similar to memory interface. So the address space for 8086 is like this. The memory address space is 2x20, which is able to address 1 megabyte locations. So each address will have 8 bit data. So we have 20 address lines. In the case of IO address, we have 64 kilobytes locations. So only 16 address lines will be used for IO address space. Then the types of IO. So we have three types. First one is called as the programmed IO, next one interrupt IO, and the third one block transfers. So programmed IO, it is also called as polling, wherein the normal program execution will happen if at all there is any IO operations expected, then the program will keep on checking the IO device whether the data is required or to be passed on is required. So it keeps on checking the IO device, that's why it is called as polling. So next one is interrupt IO, wherein the normal program execution will continue. If at all any requirement from the IO device, it will interrupt the normal flow by means of a separate line called as interrupt, after which the interrupt service routine takes care of the information. Third one is block transfer, which requests a specialized system component such as a DMA to transfer a sequence of bytes or words. Next, we will see the IO instructions. So first instruction is IN instruction, the short form IN AL, port, wherein the contents of port address will be copied to AL or moved to AL. Long form IN AX, port, wherein the contents of port and the port address plus 1 will be moved to AX, since AX is a 16-bit register. The next instruction is OUT instruction. So you have short form and long form. So in the short form, the content of AL is moved to the port address. In the long form, the content of AX is moved to port address and port address plus 1. Next, we consider the case of a programmed IO, wherein user needs to enter some information which ends with a carriage return. So normally what happens is the system is initialized, the data is checked whether any byte of information is received, byte or word. So if it is received, then further processing, else it will wait until the data is received. Then that will be input from the IO ports will be copied to the CPU. Then it will check what needs to be done, and based on that, the byte will or word will be moved to the memory buffer. And it will check whether it has reached the received the carriage return or the enter. So if it is reached, it will process the data. If it is not reached, it will wait for the other byte or word of data. This is programmed IO, wherein it keeps on checking the IO device for data. In the case of interrupt IO, so assume we have a normal program. If it is getting executed, if it receives the interrupt, then it will go to some other address location and start executing the interrupt routine. After completing the interrupt routine, again it will come back to where it has left off, and then it will proceed further. So now we will see these steps. So this is the interface. So this is the CPU and bus logic control. This is the memory location. So what happens is, so for each type of interrupt, so where the interrupt routine starts, it is pointed by the code segment register and the instruction pointer. So these together forms the address for service routine. So now when interface IO device wants to interrupt the normal routine. So first it sends an interrupt signal. So interrupt signal is sent to the 8086. Next, that interrupt will be acknowledged by 8086 by means of the interrupt acknowledge line. After this, then the type of interrupt is communicated to the CPU through the data bus. Then the program needs to currently store its current status and the address of the next instruction into the temporary storage location, which is the stack. So the contents of the current program status word, the code segment register and instruction pointer are pushed into the stack. Next, the interrupt and trap flags are cleared. So this interrupt is cleared. Next step, the based on the type number, the interrupt service routine location is automatically determined by finding out the instruction pointer by 4*N. So if it is type 0, it is instruction pointer location is 0 and 1. Then code segment register is 2 and 3. Similarly, if it is type 4, then N into 4. 4 into 4, this is 4 into 4 plus 2. So this gives the address of the service routine. Then after interrupt, it has stored its current status and it has gone to the interrupt service routine and it start executing the interrupt service routine. So in the interrupt service routine, the interrupts are enabled so as to enable any other interrupts to happen even inside the interrupt. Okay. Then what happens is, so before returning, it should know where to go. So for that, we require the code segment and instruction pointer, which are already stored into the stack. So now it pops out the instruction pointer, code segment register, and also the program status word, which contains the flags and the accumulator register, so that the original program status is restored. After that, the return is made to the original interrupted program. So this is how the IO device operates. So normal execution will happen, an interrupt occurs, then interrupt service routine will be executed, then after completion of interrupt service routine, that the control is moved to the original program from where it has stopped for further processing. The next one is, so if you have multiple interrupts, so how to go about that? So first we have what is called as a daisy chaining. So if you have device 1, device 2, device 3, all capable of interrupting, so all these interrupt lines will be connected to the interrupt line of the 8086. Since these lines are open collector driver, any one which has caused the interrupt will make the interrupt line of the 8086 to be asserted. Now interrupt 8086 will send an interrupt acknowledge, which is taken care by the daisy chain logic. So it first checks whether device 1 has requested the interrupt. If so, interrupt acknowledge is given to device 1. If not, then it checks the next device 2. So if it has requested, interrupt acknowledge is given here. If not, it is given to the third device. So if you see here, the first device has got the highest priority because it is always checked first. Then the next lower priority is device 2. Then the last priority is device 3. So this is what is called as a daisy chaining of interrupts. Next, we will have specialist hardware to take care of the interrupt priority. So interrupt priority management is required when you have multiple interrupts. Say for example, IR0 to IR7, 8 interrupts are there, which will be latched into the request register. Then it will check the priority if more than one interrupt occurs at the same time, and it checks the type of request, and then it sends a interrupt request. Now 8086 will send the interrupt acknowledge, which is further communicated to the IO device. Then the last type of IO transfer is the block transfers and DMA. So here what happens is, DMA is direct memory access. So when we have many number of data to be communicated between the IO device and the memory, so normally any IO data will first be transferred to the 8086 or the microprocessor register from the processor register, it is again copied to the memory. So it involves two steps. When you have multiple data or block of data to be transferred, so this process is going to take much of time and much of CPU control. So for this, we have what is called as a direct memory access. In DME, the data from I/O device is communicated to the memory without involving the processor. So direct access to the memory is done by the I/O device without involving the 8086. This is called as direct memory access or DMA. So that control is taken care by the DMA controller. So first, the interface, suppose if it wants to receive data from memory, it first makes a request to DMA controller. After that, DMA controller places a bus request, because when the DMA controller is communicating with the memory, the address data bus and control bus should be under the control of DMA, and 8086 should not use, for which a request is made using the hold line. Then the 8086 grants the bus by means of this hold acknowledge signal. Now after receiving the bus grant, the DMA device places the address from which data is to be read. Then the DMA request is acknowledged to the interface, since it is now ready to receive the data. Now the memory places the data on the data bus, which is being latched in the interface, and then after communicating the data from the memory to the I/O device, the bus request is dropped. So when the hold is dropped by the DMA controller, now the bus grant given by the 8086 through HLDA is also dropped by the 8086. So in summary, we have seen the different types of I/O. So namely the programmed I/O, interrupt I/O, and block transfer and DMA, direct memory access. Thank you.